man is a symbol of wisdom and good leadership.
The number nine?
Nine.
Yep.
Nine.
Nine.
BC students, this is the end of chapter 9 right here, 9-6. Now, some of you may have read the book, The Scarlet Letter, very famous novel, one of the most famous pieces of literature in American history. It was written in 1850 by Nathaniel Hawthorne, very famous author, of course. So, what was the whole premise? Well, you had the protagonist, Hester, and she got pregnant, but she wasn't married. That didn't fly back in 1850, right? It was very embarrassing at the time, okay? Now, she had to walk around the town with this gigantic scarlet-colored capital A right there emblazoned on her shirt so that everybody could see it. It was capital A that stood for adulteress. How dare you have this situation happen outside of marriage? And of course, it was really an interesting book for 1850 to sort of, you know, give this debate. Should we be treating people like this? If she made a mistake, should we really be so harsh on her? Should society change their views? So it was a really, really interesting piece of literature. So if you haven't read it, it is one of the most famous novels of all time, definitely. Now, Mr. Wade, this is an English class. Well, I teach you a little bit of everything in this class. But how does the Scarlet Letter relate to this? Okay, now I've got some gems for you. This subject is called trig substitution. Some people erroneously call the last section that we did, like 9-5, they call that trig substitution. No, that's just U substitution, but with some trig problems, you know, the tangent secant combo, the sine cosine combo. Okay, so that when if you hear somebody confuse that, that's not really trig substitution. Trigonometric substitution is when you don't do U substitution, we're actually going to do X substitution today. How about that? The tie into the Scarlet Letter. Okay, I have heard of one or two professors out here using this little mnemonic device, so it does exist out there, but you won't find it in books or on the internet. If today you see a squared minus x squared, which is a constant squared minus a variable squared, if you spot that today, you will use what? Do you use sine, secant, or tangent? Well, it says right here you use sine. How do you remember that though? Okay. If you see x squared minus constant squared, you're going to use secant. How are you supposed to remember that? If you use x squared plus a squared, and you see that in a problem, you're supposed to use tangent. This is how you remember. If the a is in the front of your binomial here. If the A is in the front, just like the Scarlet Letter, it's a sin. Okay? Because she had to wear the capital A in front, it's a sin. Oh, you sine. Ah, nice little trick, right? If the A is in the back, x squared minus a squared, it's at the end, right? If the A is in the back, hiding in the back, it's a secret. S-E-C, secant. Yeah, nice and tricky, right? And then if it's x squared plus a squared, or, you know, that's interchangeable there. If it's addition, you're going to use tangent. So let's put tangent over here. All right, T is always tangent. I do that one all the time, right? So you really need a good mnemonic device to keep all this straight. Now, okay, Mr. Wade, I kind of get the rules of the game, but how do I use it? All right, let's go over here to example A. So in letter A, we have the integral of 1 over square root of 9 minus x squared. All right, so step number one. Let's just break this down into little small steps, okay? Identify, remember a squared was over there? Identify your a squared. It's the constant. So a squared is the 9, all right? So therefore, a must be equal to 3, so find your a first. Okay, step two. Where was the a squared? The a was in front of the minus x squared. If the a is in front, it's a sin, right? So we're going to let x equal sine of theta, but with a in front. Isn't it a sine theta? So 3 is your coefficient. X equals a sine theta, okay? As long as you do that, the whole thing should work. So just kind of remember the Scarlet Letter and that mnemonic device over there. Now, if you have x, So this will get inserted there. We also need dx to insert something there. So you need x and the derivative of x. A little bit like Oklahoma method that we did in the first semester, kind of, where you find x dx, shove it in there, and just go with it. Very similar, but then completely different in many ways. So what's the derivative of 3 sine theta? 3 stays, sine goes to cosine of theta. The derivative of theta is 1, because it's just like x, okay? That's your setup, that puts you on the proper path. Third step to this crazy thing called trig substitution. SOHCAHTOA from integrated 3, all right? Who discovered SOHCAHTOA? I don't know if we ever mentioned it before. He's number 11 all time. Number 11, Euclid, the guy who founded all of geometry. They even call it Euclidean geometry. Amazing that he was back in the ancient times in the BC era in ancient Greece, and he's still number 11. That tells you something, all right? So guess what? Any kind of sine, cosine, tangent discovery, all the trig discoveries, those go back to the BC era. About 290 BC is right about the time he would have been discovering this, long time ago. Okay, SOHCAHTOA, sine equals opposite over hypotenuse, right? Things like that. SOHCAHTOA works, but only if you can get sine by itself, not with the 3. So what you're gonna do, you're gonna take your x substitution and you're just gonna write a little note to yourself. We are gonna use the box, but as a side note, if you divide both sides by 3 and isolate the trig function, isn't sine of theta technically x over 3? So you're gonna do this and you're gonna think about SOHCAHTOA. Sine, opposite, hypotenuse, so, right? Draw a picture, okay? SOHCAHTOA only works for right triangles, so I draw a right triangle. Take theta, put it in one of the two corners that's not a right angle. I always put mine down here, doesn't really matter where you put yours. Theta, the sine of theta, so opposite from theta over here is apparently x. Hypotenuse is apparently 3. Now, use the Pythagorean theorem to find the missing side, all right? So, x squared plus b squared equals 3 squared, all right? 3 squared is 9. I'm trying to find the missing side, b. So let's get b squared by itself. Let's subtract the x squared away. B squared is 9 minus x squared. Take the square root of both sides. Don't worry about the plus or minus, by the way. That won't be important here. Okay, because you are supposed to put a plus or minus in other situations. And b is apparently the square root of 9 minus x squared. All right, let me put that up here in my drawing. Add this to your triangle, please. And you get the square root of 9 minus x squared goes up there. Okay, so this is our triangle kind of behind the scenes. We're not going to use it yet, but you want to do it first. And then at the very end of the problem, we're going to go back and refer to this triangle. Okay? All right, by the way, that is a great sign, no pun intended, that's a great sign that the missing side was square root of 9 minus x squared, because that's in the problem, and that's why this mnemonic device works. It produces a Pythagorean theorem that produces the thing that's sitting there in the problem. So that's on purpose. Now, let's go ahead and label this actually step 4. I like that as a separate step. Step 4 was the Pythagorean theorem. We can now hop across the line. Let's do step 5. Let's use our x substitution, shove it in the problem, and watch the beauty unfold before your very eyes. Because it will work, I promise. Okay, we've got 1 on top. We've got the square root of, I'll make it a little bit longer here, 9 minus x squared, which would be 3 sine of theta quantity squared. If you square the 3, that'll be a 9. And if you square the sine, that'll be, of course, a sine squared. All right? And the dx becomes 3 cosine of theta. Doggone it, I missed my d theta. Sorry, that was supposed to be 3 cosine theta and then technically d theta, right? You need a d something to do an integral. So I'm going to put this at the end where dx used to be. Times 3 cosine theta d theta, all right? Kind of looks like a mess, but don't worry. The beauty's going to unfold right here.
All right, now we look for trigonometric identities as we did two sections ago. Right in here, you've got 9 minus 9 sine squared of theta. I wish it could be 1 minus sine squared theta because that's the Pythagorean identity. It can be if you factor the 9 out, okay? So let's just write this right here. I'm going to factor the 9 out, but not all the way out of the radical. Just put it in the front, but under the radical. Wouldn't that be 1 minus sine squared of theta now? Okay, factor your 9 out. Now let's go to the next step, all right? So step 6, after you factor, you do something with this. All right, what's on the top? 1 and also 3 cosine theta. Let's just go ahead and put that on the top. Drop the 1, we don't need the 1, right? On the bottom, you have 9, but now you can take the square root of it. You couldn't here because it was subtraction. Now factoring makes multiplication. That's when you're allowed to actually take the square root. The square root, as it escapes the radical, becomes 3. Left inside is 1 minus sine squared, which we know from the other day, 1 minus sine squared is cosine squared. So you're trying to do the trig identities here, okay? And then let's see, we got our cosine, so d theta is the only thing left. And now you start to see the beauty of it right here, okay? Step six. Step 6 is just keep simplifying, all right? 3's cancel, that's nice. Cosine is on top. The square root of cosine squared is just a regular cosine. And the cosines even cancel, and you end up getting the integral of 1 d theta. All right? So the integration. So step 7 is go ahead and do the integration once you get to something that you know how to integrate, which you will. It'll be on the board of 9 things. So integration of 1 is normally x. Sometimes it's t. Sometimes it's all kinds of things in this class. Sometimes it's u. Today, the integration of 1 is going to be theta, because we're in theta world, right? Integration of 1 is theta plus c, all right? Now, you can't leave it with theta, but you're super close to the right answer. If you leave it as theta, but we started with x, that wouldn't be right. We need to go back to x world, because that's where you began, okay? Otherwise, no math professor in college will take it. So, we need to convert theta back into something in terms of x. That's where you go back to your triangle. Your triangle helps you convert from theta world to x world. That's why we drew it. That's the whole reason it's there, okay? So let's see, what is theta? Well, let's see here. Theta is in here, theta is over there. Oh, wait a minute, hold on. I know what sine of theta equals, but I just want theta. How do you get rid of sine? Don't you get rid of sine by doing inverse sine? Take the inverse sine of this side and they'll cancel out. So let's put it over here. Okay, step 8, convert back. Inverse sine of sine theta would cancel it out. On the other side, you would get the inverse sine of x over 3. Okay, so I put an inverse sine on that, all right? So apparently theta is really sine inverse of x over 3. This is a rare one where you could look back at just the substitution, but normally you would actually have to work within the triangle, which I'll show you a lot of those, okay? This time, I guess we didn't really have to. We could just do like, you know, opposite to both sides. Now, theta is replaced by this. So do your substitution basically back. Step 9 is the final answer. Theta becomes inverse sine of x over 3 plus c, or also acceptable, arc sine of x over 3 plus c. Arc sine or inverse sine, remember they're very similar, and they would take either one in this case right here, okay? So your final answer. Now, if anybody thinks we've done this before, we have. Let's take a look at that original question there. Lesson 3-6, letter F, is where it happened in the first semester. I gave you this exact problem right here. Pretty much all of you got it right on the test.
It's on the board of nine things we can commonly integrate off the top of our head. Look at that right there. That always turns into arc sine of what? U over A, remember that? That's U over A, X over 3. Remember A was 3? So yes, if anybody saw that, and I'm sure some of you did, I like to do this in class anyway, just to show you how this works so nicely and that to prove to that it's true to you. But if you looked at that and said that's arc sine, you were actually right. So if you were to see this on the AP test, yes, you would actually just skip all this stuff and just go right here and have your final answer in one step. Yes. When do you have to do all this trig sub? The rest of the problems today, okay? They're not gonna be that easy. But it's cool to see that, oh yeah, it does confirm what we did in the first semester. Now, let's go to the other board. Let's try letter B, where you have to do the process. But now we've had our warm-up period, so now we kind of know what to expect, right? Okay, so we got this one. This is not an arc sine. First of all, this is backwards, and that can't be fixed. There's also an extra x as well. Okay, it's not. So now focus not on the x squared. Don't look at that. Focus on the binomial, the x squared minus 4, okay? Step one, a is 4. Sorry, a squared is 4. Therefore, a is 2. So let's set aside that first. The a is in the back of the 2, so it's a secret. So it's a secant, all right? We're going to let x equal a secant theta, which is 2 secant theta, according to the rules of the game. And from that, we can easily get our dx. The derivative of x is the 2 carries. Oh, we just did this one the other day, just to introduce it to you because I was planning on this moment. That's why I showed it to you. The derivative of secant is secant tangent. Remember that one? Secant theta, tangent theta. Put that d theta on there. Don't forget, Mr. Wade. All right, there is your trig substitution setup. All right, let's try it. What did we do next last time? You gotta get used to this, right? We isolated the trig function in the x expression here, the x equation. So I wanna get secant theta by itself, divide both sides by 2, and we can kind of think of this in Sokotoa form, okay? Sokotoa terms. But sine, cosine, tangent is in the Sokotoa, not secant. Secant is the reciprocal of cosine. So you can flip this over from pre-cal and call that cosine equals 2 over x. All right, even better. Now let's Sokotoa this son of a gun. All right, it's the ka in the Sokotoa. Adjacent over hypotenuse, so draw me a picture. All right, let's see. Let me draw a picture. I always draw my right triangle pointing that way. I just keep it consistent, you know, whatever makes you comfortable. I always put my theta down here in the right-hand corner, but it doesn't matter. So, cosine theta is adjacent over hypotenuse. Adjacent is 2. Adjacent to theta is right here, 2. Hypotenuse is x. Find the missing side using the Pythagorean theorem. All right, next step. 2 squared plus b squared equals x squared, all right? Get b by itself because we're trying to find this missing side right here, okay? That's 4, 2 squared is 4, subtract it over. B squared equals x squared minus 4. So the missing side b is the square root of x squared minus 4. Just take a little glance at the original function and say, well, square root of x squared minus 4, that's exactly what I wanted to get in there, and that's what that whole scarlet letter game gives you. It gives you the thing that's back there, okay? So this missing side right here is going to be square root of x squared minus 4. I'll just write it sideways, and we will come back to this at the very end. Okay, jump across the line. Let's use our box. Let's do trig substitution. Let's try to get to some kind of basic integration, the nine things we know how to integrate. And when we get to the very end, we should be able to look back at the triangle and finish it off. All right, let's try it. Okay, so what do we do? Let's put everywhere you see an x, it's gonna become a 2 secant theta, okay? So let's see. Integral, try not to write too big. There's not a lot of room if you did the printed version, all right? So don't write too big here because we've got some steps. Don't write, you don't have to write tiny either. All right, so let's start with this. X squared is going to become this squared. 2 squared is 4, secant squared. 4 secant squared of theta goes there, all right? X squared, again, becomes 4 secant squared theta, but then minus 4 with a radical over it. So same thing, let's extend this. So x squared is still 4 secant squared of theta, but then there's a minus 4 under the radical. And the dx is this whole long thing right here, 2 secant tangent d theta. So 2 secant theta tangent theta, and then I like my d theta on the side, all right? And you just start working on it. Now, one thing I notice, before I do anything else, right off the bat, I bet you notice that 2 over 4 can make 1 half, okay? Let's just put that out in the front, actually. Just scoot it out of the way, it's a coefficient. I bet you notice that secant over secant squared could cancel a pair of secants. So let's take off one of those, all that, and I'm gonna have a secant theta on the bottom, but that has departed the top, all right? Still have a tangent up there, can't do anything with that. Still have a d theta. Now remember what we focused on over there? Do you remember that this is almost one of our identities, but you should factor out the 4? So the a always gets factored out, by the way. Okay, or the a squared. The a squared was 4, so I'm gonna factor out 4 and write secant squared theta minus 1, and then if I did everything right, I should have an identity right here. I hope this is an identity. It is. Remember, secant and subtract leads to, that's basically tangent squared according to the identity. That is tangent squared of theta. Things are looking up. If this is happening while you're doing the problem, you're doing it correctly, okay? All right, 1/2 integral. This one takes a few more steps to simplify than the last one. Still not bad though, don't worry. Tangent on top, secant on the bottom. The square root of 4 becomes 2. The square root of tangent squared becomes just a regular tangent. D theta. Do you see the magic happening now? Do you see it coming together as long as you do the right thing? Tangents cancel. You can scoot the 2 out here and put it with that 2 and make it 1/4. And the only thing left, since I moved the 2 out now, the only thing left is 1 over secant. By definition, 1 over secant flips to become cosine. Secant and cosine are reciprocals of each other. After all that, I'm just integrating cosine. So let me show you what you do. You go cross-cancel crazy, cross-cancel everything you can. Make sure you factor that a squared out and then all the way out, and you should get an identity and things should just fall right in your lap. All right? The only crazy cases of these where things don't fall in your lap, you wouldn't see those until deep into college. All right? You won't see those in BC calculus. All right? We won't do the absurd ones, except for in the calculus club. We can pull out some crazy tricks up there. This is going to be reasonable. So then the next step was, oh, go ahead and integrate. The derivative of cosine is negative sine. So the integration of cosine is positive sine of theta. All integration divides by the chain rule. But the chain rule of theta is 1, so don't divide by the chain rule. I mean, it's divide by 1, plus c. Okay, didn't we say we had to finish this off by going back to the triangle? Don't leave theta, you're trying to get back to x's. What is the sine of theta? If I just knew what the sine of theta was, okay? You don't have to do the inverse sine trick like we did over there. Matter of fact, you won't have to use that at all, okay? This is what you'll actually do. Sine of theta. Go to the triangle, put your finger on the theta. We constructed the triangle based off of cosine, right? But it still works for sine, cosine, tangent, all the SOHCAHTOA. If you look at theta, the sine of theta is the opposite over the hypotenuse. That's square root of x squared minus 4 over x. 1/4 opposite over hypotenuse. Plus c. And I'll take that answer. I feel better just dropping the 1 because it's 1 times the numerator and then putting the 4 with the x. So I kind of like that answer better. But I'll be darned. That is the only family of functions whose derivative would take you back to that original integrand. Wow. I'm telling you, this stuff pumps me up. I hope somebody out there is also excited watching this because it's really cool how trig sub works. All right, let's try letter C. Now, I was tutoring some college students before at Vanderbilt, of course, and I saw this doozy right here and I thought, ooh, that's a tricky one. Took me a couple of seconds and I said, I know how to help you. The formula in trig sub works for x squared plus a squared, not x squared plus ax, right? That x is ruining everything. If that x wasn't in there, wouldn't that be plus case goes to tangent? Problem, the 6x is in there, okay? So, challenges, Mr. Wade. This one's challenging, all right? So, maybe somebody out there is thinking it right now. Because when I looked at it, I thought, I've never seen this before, but I know what to do because I've trained for a long time. I want to get you to where you can kind of do that too, your instincts. The only way to try to produce some kind of number, because I need a number at the end without an x, is to complete the square. It's another complete the square like we did in the first semester. Oh, tricky. All right, watch this. The square root of x squared plus 6x, let's just pull that off to the side, is equivalent to the square root of x squared plus 6x. Boy, I wish it was one of those things called a perfect square trinomial. Half of 6 is 3. 3 squared is a positive 9. If I had x squared plus 6x plus 9, I could just factor that because that is called a perfect square trinomial where you do the half and then the squared. But I didn't have a plus 9 there. You can't just make up a plus 9 unless I balance that with a minus 9. I just added 9 pounds to the scale and then subtracted 9 pounds from the scale and it's a balance. Okay? Now we're good. All right. Remember, this thing in here factors into x plus 3 times x plus 3, right? The old multiply add game. But x plus 3 times x plus 3 is x plus 3 quantity squared, and that's why we call those perfect square trinomials. When you do that little trick, it ends up making x plus whatever the middle number was, and then with a quantity squared, and the extra minus 9. Okay, now I know it's x plus 3 instead of x, but that's okay. This is kind of like your x, or you could even think it's a little bit like a U, all right? That was like the worst bracket I've ever drawn. It's supposed to be a sideways curly bracket. That's kind of like a U, but we're not gonna do U substitution. And so that's a U squared, and this right here is obviously an A squared, okay? So here's what you do. A is 3, obviously, okay? X dx. Let's see. Oh, see, it was a plus, so I was thinking tangent at first, but then it actually changes. It ends up being the x is here minus the constants here. The a is in the back. If the a is in the back, it's a secret. It's a secant. So this is going to be a 3 secant theta, right? A secant theta when it's a secret in the back there. Now, you would think it would be like the other board. You'd think you would do what? X and dx, right? Okay, here's the trick. Instead of x, it's x plus 3. It's the whole base. So this is a rare one where you have to do this. X plus 3 is going to be replaced by the trig function. Okay? Now let's do the derivative. The derivative of x is 1 dx, and the derivative of 3 is 0. So it still does give you the dx. And the derivative of 3 secant is 3 secant tangent, so secant theta tangent theta, d theta, okay? Slightly different. All right, now it's business as usual. Don't we isolate the trig function next? So secant theta, just to build your triangle for the end, secant theta is divide by 3, so it's x plus 3 over 3, okay? If you want, if it helps you, some people can just look at secant and just go, oh yeah, I know it's hypotenuse over adjacent. For some of you, that's weird. So flip both sides. The reciprocal of secant is cosine. The reciprocal of this is 3 over x plus 3. And ca adjacent over hypotenuse. All right? Now, let's draw a triangle.
right triangle, shove theta in the bottom corner like I always do. Adjacent from theta is 3, so that's next to it. Hypotenuse is x plus 3. Pythagorean theorem. 3 squared, which is 9, plus b squared equals x plus 3 quantity squared. Okay? Subtract 9. B squared equals x plus 3 quantity squared minus the 9. Take the square root of both sides. B equals the square root of x plus 3 quantity squared minus 9, and you hope it matches the original function. Well, the original function actually changed into this. This is what we're integrating now. It does match, and then you feel good about yourself because you know you did it right. Okay? All right, let's get a close-up and erase the board simultaneously. So I've cleaned the board up for us here. Let's insert on the missing side what we just found for B. So wasn't B square root of x plus 3 quantity squared minus 9? Let's put that there. Okay, there's our triangle. We'll come back to that later. Let's go back to what we have up here. All right. Now let's convert x world to trig world, which is why it's called trig substitution. You make it all trig. So x plus 3 quantity squared is going to be replaced by 3 secant theta quantity squared. Put that in there. Minus 9. And dx becomes all that right there, all right? Times, oh, here we go. 3 secant theta tangent theta. Has a nice ring to it, doesn't it? Secant theta tangent theta. All right, and we hope it simplifies. It will, don't worry. 3 squared is 9. Secant squared is secant squared of theta. There's your common 9. That should happen, of course, all right? Here's this 3. We'll just say C above to save you time on the notes, all right? The main goal is factor that 9 out. Let's see if you can do it in 2 steps in 1 because you're all great calculus students. Factor the 9 out, and it becomes 9 in front, but then square root it, and it becomes 3 when it escapes. Can you do that all in one step? If you can, great. If not, you don't have to. And that leaves you with secant squared of theta minus 1, okay? C above. Same. Secant squared minus 1 is equivalent to tangent squared. Let me just write tangent squared of theta instead. Now we're getting somewhere. Integration of 3, oh, times the other 3, because we're going to bring this in now. Let's go ahead and just do 3 times the other 3 is 9. Let's do that. We know the square root of tangent squared is just tangent times the other tangent. Actually bumps it, ironically, back up to tangent squared. Secant theta d theta is the left of it, or what's left of it, I should say. All right, and you get that, and this was only a setup, it was not an integrate, you're done. Now, just a little fun note. If you look on your 10 things I learned about calculus in this chapter 9, okay, now that we've gotten to the end of the chapter, because that is the end, thank you very much. This right here, the integration of tangent squared secant, it's listed as one of the rare cases of secant tangent combos where the u is not tangent, because isn't it always for this class? The u actually would be secant in this weird case. I would never expect you to integrate this on a test, all right? Too weird for now. Possible in college though, depending on how high of a college you go to, even more possible.
Very clever trig substitution was first developed in a primitive form by the genius number 1 Euler in 1755. But it was number 8 ranked Weierstrass who actually polished it off in its current form right around 1850, coincidentally the same year that the Scarlet Letter was released. This is the very last chronological discovery in BC calculus and Calc 2. Nothing was discovered after 1850. Weierstrass actually didn't even have a PhD in math back in 1850. He was a high school teacher. And in his lifetime, he handed out another 46 PhDs to other students, including the first female math PhD ever, a Russian mathematician named Kovalevskaya.
That's how you wrap up chapter 9. All right? Fantastic. Finish that sample task because we need to talk about this in class.
Hold it now.
Letter D, where you have to do the process. But now we had our warm-up. All right? Very, very simple. Okay, what do? We isolate this, but I just blew it.
I blew it. So X is going to be replaced by 3 secant theta.